HbA1c, we all know, is a trusted standard test for monitoring glycemic control and predicting complications. However, there are emerging issues complicating the interpretation of HbA1c, which we all as pathologists need to consider. So I will invite Dr. Vinanti Golvikar from Golvikar Metropolis Health Services, Pune, who will deliver her talk on nuances in HbA1 testing. Dr. Vinanti Golvikar. She has attended several national international conferences, workshop on flow cytometry at Tata Memorial Hospital, workshop on HPLC and hemoglobin electrophoresis of American Association of Clinical Chemistry at Atlanta, USA, CME on multicolor immunophenotyping, standardization and application at Tata Memorial Hospital, and many other conferences of high integrity. I also thank BioRed for facilitating this talk by her.
Please. Good morning, everybody. Thank you, madam, for the kind introduction. And at the outset, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me here and for their warm hospitality. Coming to... Coming to nuances of HbA1c testing. Nuances is a word commonly used in the field of art rather than science. So I have tried to unravel the various subtleties with respect to A1c testing in this presentation. I have covered my presentation under the following points, and I have covered quite a few interesting cases we have encountered at Golvikar Metropolis. Coming to what is HbA1c, as we all know, hemoglobin is a tetramer of two alpha and two beta globin chains. On exposure to high levels of blood glucose, hemoglobin gets non-enzymatically glycated at different sites in the molecule. HbA1c is defined as a glycohemoglobin with glucose bound specifically to the N-terminal valine residue of the beta-globin chain. Levels of HbA1c in blood reflect the glucose levels to which the RBC has been exposed during its lifespan. Thus, it is an index of the level of glycemic control over the preceding 2 to 3 months or 8 to 12 weeks. Of this period, the immediately preceding 30 days contribute 50% to A1c. It has a strong predictive value for diabetes complications. Coming to the historical aspects, the journey of A1c began in 1958 when it was separated for the first time. In 1969, its increase in diabetes was first described by Samuel Rehbar. In 1976, its use for monitoring degree of glucose glycemic control was first proposed. In 1980, the colorimetric procedure for estimation was established by Iyer and Krishnaswamy in India, and we started following this procedure at Golvikar Laboratory in 1982. Coming to the clinical interpretation of A1c values, according to the Standards of Medical Care in Diabetes 2016 by American Diabetes Association, a value of less than or equal to 5.6% is considered normal. 5.7 to 6.4% is associated with an increased risk for diabetes, called the pre-diabetes. More than or equal to 6.5% is diagnostic of diabetes. The test should be performed in a laboratory using a method that is NGSP certified and standardized to the DCCT assay. I'll elaborate this later. However, in the absence of unequivocal hyperglycemia, the results should be confirmed by repeat testing. Point of care assays, however, are not recommended for diagnostic purposes. Here, I would just like to say that for diagnosis of diabetes, HbA1c has a low sensitivity, though it is highly specific as compared to fasting blood glucose or oral glucose tolerance test values. This is just a chart giving correlation of the HbA1c value with the estimated average glucose. Like a value of 6% would be correlated with an average glucose of 126 milligram per deciliter, and for every 29 milligram per deciliter rise in estimated average glucose, A1C will go up by 1%. It is recommended that A1C be performed twice a year in patients who are meeting their treatment goals and who have stable glycemic control. However, it should be done quarterly in patients whose therapy has changed or who are not meeting their glycemic goals. Point of care testing can be used for this. What are the advantages of A1C over fasting BSL and oral glucose tolerance test? Obviously, greater convenience. Fasting is not required, greater pre-analytical stability. It is not affected by the time of the day, meal intake, exercise or just administered diabetes drugs, and there are less day-to-day perturbations due to stress and illness. Coming to A1C and glycemic targets and therapeutic goals, two primary techniques are available for health providers and patients to assess the effectiveness of their management plan. One is self-monitoring of blood glucose, the other is A1C. Now, continuous glucose monitoring, CGM devices are also available and are used as an adjunct to SMBG in select patients. So with respect to A1C, how do we decide a glycemic goal? A reasonable A1C goal in non-pregnant adults is taken at less than 7%. However, we can make this less stringent or more stringent depending on other patient and disease factors. Like, we can consider a more stringent goal of less than 6.5% for select patients if it is achievable without significant hypoglycemia or other adverse effects of drug treatment. Or we can consider a less stringent goal of, say, less than 8% for patients with a history of severe hypoglycemia, limited life expectancy, or other comorbidities that make less than 7% difficult to attain. So basically, we have to individualize the A1C goal for a patient. In pediatric age group, an A1C goal of less than 7.5% is recommended. Again, mainly because it is difficult to monitor hypoglycemia and adverse effects of treatment in this age group. In pregnant women, A1C should not be used as a primary but as a secondary measure, basically due to two reasons. The A1C levels tend to be lower in pregnancy due to physiological increases in the red blood cell turnover, and they may not fully capture the postprandial hyperglycemia which drives fetal macrosomia. However, a target of 6 to 6.5% achieved without hypoglycemia is recommended. So this is just a graph showing this glycemic goal. An optimum goal of 7% is recommended, and depending on the patient or disease factors, we can make it more or less stringent. Like, for example, if the risk associated with hypoglycemia and other drug effects is low, you can make the A1C goal more stringent, and if it is high, you can make it less stringent likewise. Coming to the various methods for measuring A1C, broadly there are three types: the enzymatic method, methods based on structural differences like the immunoassay and boronate affinity chromatography, and methods based on charge differences as in ion exchange, HPLC, and the capillary electrophoresis. The enzymatic method measures A1C using an enzyme that specifically cleaves the N-terminal valine, and this is then detected colorimetrically. In the immunoassay, an antibody is used which is targeted against the glycated N-terminal of the beta chain. Boronate affinity chromatography, in this the glycohemoglobin binds the affinity region while the non-glycated hemoglobins pass through the column. In these three methods, there is no analytical interference from the common HB variants. However, that becomes a shortcoming as in they are unable to detect the HB variants. Moreover, in boronate affinity chromatography, it measures all glycated hemoglobins and not just HbA1c. Coming to ion exchange HPLC, it separates the hemoglobin species based on charge, and it has the ability to detect the most common HB variants, though it will show some interference due to HB variants that coelute with the peak of interest. Likewise, capillary electrophoresis separates HB species based on charge and hydrodynamic volume, but throughput is a challenge in this case. We at Golbilkar Metropolis have primarily are doing A1C by ion exchange HPLC on the Bio-Rad D10 platform. Recently, we have also installed Bio-Rad Variant 2 Turbo and Toso G8. And we are using the turbidimetric inhibition immunoassay as a backup method in cases of hemoglobin variants, which we are doing on the Siemens Dimension RXL. With so many methods comes the question of standardization. In 1993, CAB data showed a lot of variability among the results from various methods, and clearly this was not acceptable in achieving specific A1C goals. Different methods needed to be calibrated to a common reference method. So in 1993, the ASCC formed a subcommittee on glycated hemoglobin standardization with the goal of standarding the assay to DCCT reference method, Diabetes Control and Complications Trial reference method. And in 1996, the National Glycohemoglobin Standardization Program was formed to implement the ASCC program. So this is a certificate from NGSP, a manufacturer certificate for the D10, which is valid for a year. Elaborating the high-performance liquid chromatography, in this the hemolysate passes through an analytical cartridge and an ionic gradient is created by a mixture of buffers. So the positively charged hemoglobin molecules bind to the negatively charged sites on the cartridge, and by the differential ionic gradient, these hemoglobin molecules are displaced. The weaker hemoglobins being displaced first and the stronger hemoglobins being displaced the last. The eluted hemoglobins are then received by the computer as a voltage signal versus time, and the area counts of the peak for each component are calculated as a percentage of the total area counts. So this is a graph from DTET, and in every case, we should go through the graph to see whether the total area count is within 1 milli... Can you see the pointer? The total area count is within 1 million to 5 million. The A1C and A0 peaks should be correctly identified. They should be sharp and symmetrical. The retention time should be consistently in range. The baseline should be stable, not drifting. Quality control values should be obviously in range, and other criteria for the D10 are the HbF should be less than or equal to 10%, labile A1C should be less than or equal to 4%, carbamylated hemoglobin less than equal to 3.5%, P3 peak which correlates with the sample integrity should be less than 10%. This needs to be validated by the individual lab. The A1C by D10 on this platform, if in the presence of HbS trait and HbC trait, you can result the A1C report, but in cases of other variant hemoglobins, you cannot report it. So here I would like to exemplify the importance of going through the graph in each and every case by one case we encountered. So this was a 51 years female, known diabetic, on follow-up at our lab since 2010. Her GHB on March 2016 came to be 9.1%, and she was not happy with the result, so we asked for a fresh sample, and on 24th March it came to be 8.3%. Obviously in 1 week that was substantial difference for GHB, so we asked for a third sample and again it showed 8.2%. So if you can see within the three graphs, the A1C peaks marked in purple in the second and the third case are sharp and symmetrical, whereas the peak in the first case is broad and flattened, and it has given a falsely high value. So here we are really looking at the nuances of the A1C graph, and it was in the first case a random error by the machine, and we released an amended report as 8.3%. Coming to the factors influencing A1C results. Primarily, it is the red cell survival or the red cell turnover. Like in iron deficiency, B12 deficiency, renal impairment, alcoholism, the red cell turnover is reduced, so the red cell lifespan is increased, and there is a false increase in A1C value. As in, the A1C value would reflect glycemic control not over, say, 3 months, but say over 4 months. On the other hand, when there is supplementation of iron, B12, folic acid, resulting reticulocytosis, in the presence of hemolysis, when there is a shortened red cell survival, the A1C value would be falsely reduced. Again, it will reflect a glycemic control of a lesser lifespan of, say, 2 months rather than 3 months. Similarly, glycation rate is another factor. If increased, it will falsely elevate the A1C value, as seen in vitamin C or E deficiency and some hemoglobinopathies, and inherently the assay characteristics. I would like to elaborate this with various cases. So coming to limitations of A1C, it does not provide a measure of glycemic variability or hypoglycemia. Patients prone to glycemic variability are best evaluated by the combination of self-monitoring of blood glucose and A1C. Again, I would like to show a case here. This was a 33 years male patient, known diabetic, on follow-up, and his fasting, repeatedly, his fasting values were within the normal range with high PP values. GHB was around 6. We asked for a fresh sample because we found that the values are not correlating. He gave it after 10 days. Again, GHB was still 6. We did it by immunoassay. It was still 6.1. So it was the true GHB value, but this patient had highly fluctuating blood sugar levels. So in such a case, A1C is not ideal for monitoring glycemic control and predicting microvascular complications, and self-monitoring of blood glucose may be necessary. We just did HPLC variant 2 in this patient, and it showed a normal pattern. So there was no hemoglobinopathy and no other reason for a discrepant A1C value. Coming to the next factor, as I just discussed, red blood cell turnover, as in hemolysis or blood loss. So this was a 59 years male referred to our lab for glycated hemoglobin. This sample came to us from another laboratory which got a very low result for A1C. So our A1C on D10 was 2.1%. Our A1C by immunoassay came to be 2.4%. So we just did a PBS of this sample and it showed autoagglutination. So we just out of interest did direct Coombs test, it came out to be positive. So this was a case of autoimmune hemolytic anemia because of hemolysis, shortened red cell survival. And that's why the A1C value by both D10 and immunoassay was falsely, was low. Basically it was a true value but low because of the shortened red cell survival. Glycemic control to be measured by alternate method like fructosamine or glycated albumin in such patients. Coming to presence of hemoglobin variants, several cases here. This is a 35 years male referred to our lab. On the D10, A1C came out to be 18.4%, an estimate of 78%. So looked like a sickle cell disease case. A1C was done by immunoassay, it was 4.3%. But again, even it may not be right to report an A1C value by immunoassay because it will be a falsely low value due to the underlying hemolysis in the patient. So glycemic control in this patient would be needed to be monitored by an alternate method like fructosamine or glycated albumin. We just ran the variant to HPLC, again revealed S window of 73.8%, a picture suggestive of sickle cell disease, could be homozygous HBS or HBS beta thalassemia. This is another such case, 30 years female, referred for routine antenatal profile, glycated hemoglobin, hemolytic anemia workup. She was clinically asymptomatic. Her HB was normal, PBS showed normocytic normochromic RBCs. A1C on D10 showed a value of 4.2%, but on reviewing, the labile A1C was 31%. We ran it on variant 2, it showed an F-wind of 29.9%. So 30 years female, clinically asymptomatic, normocytic, normochromic RBC indices. So this was suggestive of a heterozygous hereditary persistence of fetal hemoglobin. We did the A1C by immunoassay, but it was 3.8%. Again, a falsely low value due to the presence of HbF more than 10%. Glycemic control to be measured by an alternate method like fructosamine or glycated albumin. We have recently installed the variant 2 turbo and GA. So I am showing graphs from all the three machines here. This is a 19 years female student from Nigeria who had come to our lab for a routine workup. Clinically asymptomatic, CBC PBS was normal. Her A1C value on D10 was 4.7%, but she showed a C window of 30.2%. Likewise on variant 2 turbo, and on Tosho there was a variant window with A1C 5%. I hope I was audible so long. Heterozygous HBC disease was confirmed on variant 2 HPLC. We released the D10 value of A1C in this case because HBC trait and S trait are not supposed to interfere in A1C values on by HPLC. Another such case, 34 years male, clinically asymptomatic, CBC PBS normal. On D10, A1C was 5.3% with S window of 36.2%. On variant 2 turbo, again 5.3%, but it showed a variant window here and not S window of 37.1%, and a variant window on Tosho as well. Did it by immunoassay, 5.7%. So A1C value on all platforms was more or less correlating. This is the graph of turbo and GA. On HPLC variant 2, it revealed a D window of 35.3%. So it was a case of heterozygous HBD disease. This is a 30 years female for antenatal profile, hemoglobin 11.6%, RBC showed moderate anisocytosis, microcytosis, hypochromia with few target cells and mild polychromasia. The D10 value of A1C gave a value of 0%. So obviously it could not be reported. We reviewed, there was a variant window. Likewise, turbo also gave no A1C value. On G8, there was no variant window, but it gave a flag. By immunoassay, the A1C value came to be 5.2%, but again a case of homozygous HB variant, so it should be followed by an alternate method of glycemic control rather than an alternate method of HbA1c. On HPLC variant 2, we got HbA2 level of 79.7%, suggestive of HBE disease, which was confirmed by capillary electrophoresis. These are again similar cases. We got A1C values of 0% with a variant window 83.3%, suggestive of some homozygous hemoglobin variant. It came out to be HBD disease on HPLC variant 2. And another such case, only thing, she had mild anemia with mild anisocytosis, microcytosis, hypochromia in this case, and a D window of 82.9%, A2 of 3.9%, so most possibly this was HBD beta thalassemia. In this case, this 31 years female for antenatal profile, again clinically asymptomatic, CBC PBS normal, A1C value came to be 55.2% on D10. Obviously could not be reported. We did it by immunoassay. It came out to be 5.2%. On variant 2, we got a P2 window of 50.3%. Beta globin gene sequencing was done and it was a clinically silent beta chain variant HB Sherwood Forest. Similar case, A1C value 50.5%. A P2 retention window on variant 2, which was confirmed as hemoglobin hope by capillary electrophoresis. This is another case wherein there is a variant window and it came out to be heterozygous HB Lepore. I'll just go over these cases. What I want to stress here is in the presence of heterozygous hemoglobin variants, we can report the A1C report by HPLC in most of the cases, but it is always better to confirm it by an alternate method of HbA1c like immunoassay. However, in case of homozygous variants, A1C as an assay itself cannot be used for glycemic control, and we need to use an alternate method like fructosamine or glycated albumin in such cases. Coming to the last point, there are limited studies that have been done on how A1C relates to the average glucose in children or in different ethnicities. There are some studies which say African American population has higher A1C for the same mean average glucose as compared to the Caucasian population. So in these are the areas of further study. Coming to the alternative methods of glycemic control, we have fructosamine. It is a ketoamine formed from joining fructose to the protein molecule, mostly albumin through non-enzymatic glycation. It is a measure of glycemic control over 2 to 3 weeks. Likewise, glycated albumin, a measure of glycemic control over 2 to 3 weeks. 1,5-anhydroglucosidol, commonly known as Glycomark. It is a deoxy form of glucose which competes with glucose for reabsorption by the kidney, and its serum value is inversely proportional to the blood glucose levels. It is a measure of short-term glycemic control over 24 hours. So why not just do the blood sugar? Why go for this Glycomark? Because it gives an average value over the period of 24 hours, whereas the blood sugar would be a particular value, either fasting, PP, at a specific point in time. Another interesting case, 60 years female, known diabetic under excellent glycemic control, routine health checkup was done. Her A1C by on D10 came to be 4.7%. By immunoassay, 5%. Her fasting sugar was 141 milligram per deciliter, PP sugar 170 milligram per deciliter. So somehow her sugar values and A1C were not correlating. Actually, that is the reason we rechecked A1C on immunoassay. We also performed HPLC on this. It was normal pattern, no variant detected either on the D10 or the variant 2 graphs. BSL and A1C not correlating. So we called the patient for history, and she had a recent history of steroid treatment over the previous 10 days for a skin disorder, which had resulted in her deranged sugar values, but her A1C value, which reflected the glycemic control over 3 months, was coming normal. Here I would like to show a short video of the journey of Goldwilker lab with A1C. Which started with the colorimetric method in 1982. First Bio-Rad D10 was installed in 2007, followed by variant 2 and the second Bio-Rad D10. We started with colorimetry and continued. HPLC D10 came in 2007, variant 2, second D10, our immunoassay on Dimension RXL. Recently we have installed the Tosho and variant 2 turbo. This is our workload over the years. We were performing around 7,000 tests in 2010 to currently more than 40,000 tests in 2016. Here I have taken this graph specifically to show when we need to review the cases, out of the total more than 40,000 cases that we had, we needed to review in 3.63%, 1,490 cases, which either showed a variant window or total area count high or low. Okay, so the D10 or the HPLC values had to be reviewed for these reasons. We had to either run it on by an alternative method or release the report with a comment. The total area count which comes low is usually in cases of anemia. So the sample needs to be rerun in dilution. And again, the anemia can cause a falsely elevated or low value of A1C. So we release such reports with a comment. This is our IQC data for the month of November 2016, our ECAS data for the month of November, and the summary of our ECAS last year. Here I would like to acknowledge the Bio-Rad team and the entire team of Golwilka Metropolis for helping me put up this presentation. On this side is our team of technologists who process A1C, that's Dr. Golwilkar, and without their help, I would not have been able to put up this presentation. I thank you all for your patient listening. I would love to take questions, if any.